Hello, hello, everybody. It is 7:56 a.m. Central Time on the 14th of June, 2018. Hope you are doing well. We are here on the Earthquake 3D live stream, early morning edition. And we're here to talk about seismic events that have hit since last night at my update at 10 p.m. Central Time. So let's get a display capture turned on and let's go jump into the earthquakes. What's hit since last night? So to see it, let's go turn on the last several hours worth of quakes. And where we're going to start, we're going to start with last night with our direct earthquake forecast hit down here at the Costa Rica, Panama region. Costa Rica is where the letter V is, and Panama is to the east, obviously. We got a 5.3, and we were looking for a 5.3 to be coming in here. And then last night, after my update, a new deep earthquake, 4.9, came in at 564 kilometers deep, and that's definitely going to be causing shallower, larger movement. And we can consult our depth to magnitude conversion chart, and if we go look at 560, well, you'll see at 560 we need to add on 1.1 magnitude to this deep quake. And if we add on 1.1 magnitude, that takes us to 6.0. So we're looking for the potential of a 6.0 now, directly next to this deep quake. Now, when I say directly next to, it could be in the silent zone to the west, most likely to the west. We have seen in the past, there have been some times where deep earthquakes happen here on the letter D, and we see new activity strike in the Kermadec. Mostly, though, the flow goes to the west, which way the arrows are. It depends on where this strikes in relation to our southern transfer zone, which you can see the arrow pointing down towards New Zealand. In New Zealand, since last night, the only activity I really have to bring to you is a new mid-range 3 that struck down at the south tip of the South Island, at the southern tip of the Southern Alps. And then going up the coast, we have a series of 1s and 2s. The highest we're going is 2.2, two sets of 2.2s, so it's about the same size energy going across the entire area. Now, we need to jump all the way back over across, and what we'll see here is a new 5.6 on our transfer zone down towards the South Sandwich Islands. And I brought this up in last night's broadcast, that I'm waiting for this force to travel down and around and come over to our letter X. Well, if we need any more signs that something's getting ready to happen here, the force is coming down and around the bend, and this time it looks like it's actually going around the bend as opposed to our travels underneath point. Sometimes, most of the time, we see force travel underneath the south tip of South America and make a beeline right towards the South Sandwich Islands, where the Pacific plate meets up with the Atlantic. Okay, so another way to look at this too is almost the same sized earthquake striking on both sides of South America, north and south. Okay, now let's go all the way over to the west. Let me get a different display capture turned on here. I want to show you something here. Well, let's see. Where is it? Okay, Google Earth. There we go. All right. So we're going to come over here now, and I want to show you something on Google Earth that might make a little bit more sense to you. When we show it on Earthquake 3D, it sometimes just doesn't register with people. Now, look at the area to the west of our deep earthquake here. Clearly, you'll see there's no earthquakes here at all spreading across this entire area. Well, when we look on it on here, the area is littered with volcanoes, and we really pick up right here where there's a cluster of volcanoes across eastern Papua New Guinea. Then you'll kind of notice there's no marked volcanoes from the Smithsonian in western Papua New Guinea. So eastern Papua New Guinea littered with different volcanic ranges, and there were four volcanoes simultaneously erupting in here over the past several days. Now, I did not check the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center this morning. Oh, by the way, the USGS live stream is just kaput. I'm going to have to suggest, if somebody from the USGS is listening, if you're at the HVO, I know you're new to live streaming, so you might not know what the problem even is here. And let me just hit play and show you. You see your fast seconds up here? It's going in bursts and packets. You are broadcasting in 720p HD. But the highest resolution that we're getting at our end is 480p. And what you're doing is you're overusing bandwidth. I would assume, and sometimes assuming is wrong, but I would assume you're using live broadcasting software at the USGS, maybe something like OBS here, and you would need to go into the settings mode and go to the video settings and reduce your resolution from 720 down to 480. And what you're going to find is that's going to free up the bandwidth coming out of the HVO offices there. And you're not going to bottleneck. You're not going to buffer. You're not going to have any problems. You'll be all green across the board down here, and you'll be able to use less bandwidth when you're not broadcasting in full HD. Okay, and now I'm broadcasting in 1080p HD at 60 frames a second here in Missouri, and this is the bandwidth that's required to do that. So as long as you've got about 2300 to 3300 kilobytes per second or 3.3 megabytes, 2 to 3 megs a second, then you should be able to upload or upstream your live stream in HD. If you don't have this, you have less than this, it's going to start going yellow and red, and that will then cause the buffering issue that we're getting on the USGS and the packet issue where this is, again, look at the seconds here. Well, let me hit play on this. Look how fast that's going. See, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Then it'll stop, and then it'll pick back up. So it's a bottleneck that's happening coming from the HVO. We've identified that problem. Again, I've been through that. I know exactly what I'm talking about on that. If they're listening, that's what you need to do. And you just adjust it down for the time that your bandwidth is sucking right now. So you just change it down to 480p for a couple days, and then you switch it back to 720 after, you know, whatever issue. I would think that the issue probably is the volcanic eruption nearby. Maybe some electromagnetic discharge from the volcano. Who knows? But it's definitely having a problem with the bandwidth coming out of Hawaii. All right, now let's go all the way over to the west. And we don't have any earthquakes since last night to report to you in Japan or the West Pacific or even coming out of Sumatra. But India got hit today. And this is west of all of our warned areas. We were looking at Myanmar to Nepal, and then we get like about a country distance even further to the west. North India caught it. So what were we looking for? We were looking, well, and we still are. We still have all week, the rest of the week to go. I mean, today is Thursday. We got Friday, Saturday, Sunday still to go. But we're looking first here and then here. And instead, what happened is now all the way over here, we get a 4.5. Well, I think, now again, I can't prove this. I think this 4.5 came from 4.0 and greater activity that's been striking up here in Xinjiang, China, that's not making it to the USGS or EMSC feed. You go over to the Chinese agency, and maybe someday I'll do that, but it takes forever for the dang site to load. I have to remember to load it beforehand. And I guess that's because, it's probably going through every sensor filter in the world. But you go check the Chinese feed, and it does show earthquakes that are happening out here, specifically across northern China. So it's likely that this 4.5 came from fours or upper fours that struck across China over the past few days, and it came right into North India, which means we're still looking from Nepal to Myanmar. Both should get hit. We should see a progression come up across Myanmar, go over to Nepal, and then we should see all this recombine and go into Iran and South Europe. Now, speaking of Iran and South Europe, Iran today, no earthquakes yet. Oh, right? That's good for the people in Iran. Yesterday, you got hit across the country with fours. Now, we go over to the west from there, and we get into Europe. Look who got hit today. Northwest France. Oui? Yeah, okay. Well, you guys got a small 2.7 next to the English Channel. I would say that's to the south of the English. Here's the English Channel. And it's on the peninsula point to the south of there. And we had warned the English Channel for this week, as well as the area to the north. Well, near the English Channel. I'll call this a miss. It's over 200 miles, I think. I probably should do a measurement to the mouth of the English Channel just so I can find out if it's an earthquake forecast hit or not. Come along with me on a voyage of discovery as we go to find out how far this is. So the earthquake struck down here off south of Brittany, and we were looking towards the English Channel. Is it 200 miles? 160. 200 miles takes us all the way over to coast of Normandy. All right. Okay. Well, that's an earthquake forecast hit then. Wow. All right. Glad I measured. not that it matters to anybody. It's a 2.7. It just matters to me. If I name an area and I want to see it get hit and an earthquake strikes within 200 miles, that's an earthquake forecast hit. So English Channel got hit by the leftovers coming up across Europe. That's normal. It's not that big of a deal right now because, again, it's small. But if we get bigger earthquakes, then this number up at the English Channel goes up. And we've seen it go up into the 4 range, causing slight damage and in the people in the area, waking them up in the middle of the night when a 4.0 earthquake strikes up near the English Channel. And that's happened just a few times in the past. I want to say maybe 3 or 4 times in the past several years, we see activity come across Europe and strike at the English Channel. But right now, all the other areas have been hit as expected, and I mean directly as expected. So we saw activity over in Romania, activity right at the center at Croatia, activity at the center over at Italy. Going out to the west, the only thing missing now is an Azores earthquake in the mid-range 3 to maybe possibly even 4.0 range. That we would expect that at some point very soon. So that's the activity coming across Europe. I think it's pretty obvious which way it goes. We get our 4s striking in Asia and Middle East, and then the 4s go down to 3s once we get over to Central Europe, and 3s go down to 2s once we spread out across the plate. So it's taking a step down, but it takes a whole continent for that step down to happen. What else? Oh, in the last day, we're tail-ending out on the event in the West Pacific. Just look at this, man. In the last 48 hours to 72 hours, it looks like a sideways letter A. Do you see this? So, I mean, really, if you turn this on its side, I can't do that with Earthquake 3D, but if you were to turn this on the side, it would look like a letter A with the largest earthquake at the top of the letter A, at the pinnacle of it. So we would call this the crux. So at the crux of the top, or at the crux of the side where the fulcrum meets, or the hinge of the West Pacific is hinging on this point. The hinge point, the westernmost point, is the point that has the biggest earthquake that went up to 6.0. So that's just the last 48 hours. I think it's pretty obvious. The whole West Pacific moved, and our middle point in between, completing the crossover or the bar of the letter A, going right past Guam. We get up to the north, though. We get into Alaska, and we have a new earthquake striking next to Bogoslav and Cleveland Volcano at 170 kilometers deep. That just struck today, 4.1 magnitude. It's not exactly a very deep earthquake. It's at 170 kilometers, which means that, you know, it's just below the threshold of what I consider a deep event, which is 200 kilometers. So it's right there. It's next to the volcano. Likely it means there's going to be something going on here, guys. That's the, what, third earthquake this week to strike next to these volcanoes. Specifically, Cleveland shows up on the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center time after time after we see earthquakes strike next to it. Let's go over to the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center, see who's on it. Yasser in Vanuatu, Dukono in Indonesia, Sabankaya in Peru, Yasser again, Dukono, Sakurajima, Sabankaya, Yasser, and then we go into yesterday. Yesterday's list was just through the roof, man. It was really long. And today, it's much, much less. But then again, we're only at 8 a.m. Central Time. I still have all day to go for this list to fill in. So just as a point of reference, Vanuatu, Indonesia, Peru, Vanuatu, Indonesia, Japan. And that's where we kind of drop off right now. So what's going on in Hawaii? Well, aside from the live stream issue where you can't see the live stream anymore, we have a cluster, an ongoing swarm at Kilauea, and Kilauea is fully collapsed. It's collapsing into the caldera, and last night I noticed something while looking at the HVO feed that apparently nobody else noticed in the entire planet. Go figure, right? You know, I'm not bragging or anything. I'm just telling you, you know, it's just the story of my life, apparently. I guess I'm kind of a little bit, what is it, OCD, just a little bit detail-oriented. You can talk to my wife about that. She'll definitely tell you that I'm a little bit of a detail-oriented person. Sometimes that's good, sometimes that's bad. It depends on if the dishes are dirty or not. All right, and that's the truth. All right, so here we go. We're looking at the warnings, the alerts put out by the HVO, Hawaiian Volcano Observatory. And this is as of yesterday. So today, at some point, they will update this. I'm sure they're probably have dreams of sugar plum fairies dancing in their head right about now, or dutchsinse fairies, depending on who they're having to deal with. And I want to say, I do have to say this, and I know it contradicts somewhat of what I've said about the USGS, but I am going to, you know, check myself a little bit here. That much love to the people at the HVO and the USGS, and I mean it for real, much love. There's good people that are there. I got an email the other day, really made me feel bad. It made me feel like a real jerk. And it was somebody's kid who wrote me. And I actually am positive it's a kid, all right? So I verified, I've actually conversed somewhat with them. And, you know, just let them know. They wrote me because they were concerned that I was saying that the people at the HVO were corrupt and that they were doing something wrong that could hurt or harm people. And I was specific about what I said in the video, but if you're a kid listening or something, you might not get the picture. I'm talking about the agency USGS ran out of Washington, D.C. and by FEMA and DHS, Department of Homeland Security. So when I'm directing my pointed anger at censorship and those things, that's who I'm directing. I want the people at the USGS and the HVO to know this too, in case you don't, that over many years, I got smeared hard by the agency and the mainstream media working hand in hand. So like a public press release issued from the USGS such and such office, and it's not coming from just, it doesn't even have a name signed to it, right? But it's like slamming dutchsinse, you know? And if you don't know about these things, you got to go check it out. I mean, they really have issued press releases just dogging me hard. And then the mainstream media doesn't even seek me out for comment, reprints what they say, and trash me on everything from volcanoes to small earthquakes in the 2.0 range, guys. So, again, when I'm pointing my anger or my frustration at what I consider to be censorship, I'm pointing it at the corporate entity of the greater agency. Now, the people that are working at HVO, much love to you. You guys, I mean, you're dealing with a situation that has to be a little bit stressful. I think that would be a good way to put it. And also intriguing, scientifically intriguing, to the point where there's people that are trying to seize upon that. And I am dealing with people that online here on YouTube who I'm trying to deal with here. You know, there's people that are saying there's going to be tsunamis and people that are going to saying that Mauna Loa is going to erupt. And all I'm doing is showing the earthquakes. I don't think Mauna Loa is going to erupt. I've already said it. I don't think it's likely. It's possible, but possible and likely are two entirely different things. Possible is like, well, it's possible that, you know, that aliens could land on the White House front lawn today. It's possible it could happen. I mean, you know, I mean, there is a possible 1% chance or 0.1% chance that some kind of intelligent civilization could come down and land on the White House lawn. I mean, it's possible, but it's not likely. Same for Mauna Loa. We're having small earthquakes strike there all around the volcano, but it's not a sign of an eruption. It's my contention that Mauna Loa would have hundreds and hundreds of moderate to small earthquakes all around Mauna Loa as the magma chamber shifts and causes any kind of rupture in the crust. So the small earthquakes that are happening there around there are troubling to me because they're being censored. They're being deleted. They're being ignored. They were being diminished just a few days ago by the USGS, who issued a public press release statement saying that we're at background levels and there's been no increase in seismic activity at Mauna Loa. Well, we know that's not true. So when an agency issues a statement that directly conflicts with what we're seeing in front of us, that then I kick in and I have to say things about the agency that I would never normally even think or say or even worry about. It's not like I'm walking around all day like sitting here, oh, I wonder what the USGS is saying today. I just do my forecasting and use the agencies that make the information public. Sometimes it's the Russians, sometimes it's the Europeans, sometimes it's the Chinese, sometimes it's the USGS, and I have to use the USGS for all my U.S. reporting. So, I mean, I'm kind of like my hands are tied. I don't have any other agency that's going to be reporting to us all the U.S. small quakes. So in Hawaii, what's going on right now, the collapsing crater has now expanded into the caldera. And this is going to lead me over to the multimedia page where I will show you guys again. First of all, we have a great HD picture of the collapsed crater into the caldera. So here's the great picture. It's incredible. This is the former floor of the crater, part of it, and it's laying down there about 500 to 1,000 feet, God knows how deep. They said 1,200 feet, 1,000 to 1,200 feet deep is where this is going. So I said thousands, stand corrected, it's 1,200 or 1,000 something feet down to the bottom of here. But you're going to notice something missing. The lava lake is gone. The tube that fed it is gone. And all that's left now is a giant hole in the ground Well, we're going to go down. I'm going to show you an animated GIF image, which the USGS put out a few days ago. And this is the one that really should just, you know, draw your attention. And I want you to look over here on the left-hand side of the screen and look over here on the right-hand side of the screen. And as you look on the left-hand side of the screen, you're going to see clear subsiding and sliding that's happening, not just the crater. I mean, I guess you could call it the crater. It's the caldera now. Now, the crater is expanding in the caldera, so it's still a crater. I mean, don't get me wrong. It's a crater. I mean, you could call it a crater, but it's going into the caldera. You couldn't even call this the crater anymore. The crater that was there is gone. And now that you've seen both sides of this, I want you to look right at the middle, and you see these little dark splotches down here at the bottom of the screen. Those are trees. And the tree top is visible right over the hillside here. There's two of them, one here, and if you look all the way down here where my mouse is, hopefully you guys are seeing all this, you look all the way down here on the right-hand side of the screen, all the way to the right, there's a little black splotch there, and that these trees have fallen. Now, where are the trees? The trees, let me take you back over on Google Earth here, the trees are right at the bottom of the cliff below the HVO, below the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory. Whoa, what just happened there? Google Earth running fast today. Wow, I guess it works good early in the morning. I've never seen it move that fast. That's crazy. So here's Kilauea. Here's the crater right here. And the crater caldera is the oval shape, and these are the cliff sides. So here's the HVO, and the camera for the HVO is pointing from this side of the building down at an angle this way and looking down here onto the lava lake. So the trees that are in question were right here. And right here, right on the second tier, the closest tier to the HVO. Okay, so that's what's going on there. And if we've got trees collapsing there and steam coming up from right there, then you can understand that the HVO is teetering on the edge of an area that's collapsing now. That's not my take on it. The trees have fallen, and the trees are not down here. There are no trees down here. The only trees that are visible from the HVO are right here. And if the trees are falling here, then this spot's collapsing here, and we're way above the caldera. And it means that we're not only expanding into the caldera, we are expanding beyond the caldera, that the caldera is growing, not just the crater. That's a fact, Jack. You can take that and put it to any professional. And I've just shown you the proof. Now, somebody else told me that there's been a drone flyover of the crater. So I guess we need to probably go to the USGS YouTube page. Let's go to the USGS YouTube page. See if they have a live flyover or any kind of flyover of the site here. Let's USGS videos. Nope. No flyover there. Okay, well, let's go back over here and see if we've got a flyover publicly posted on their page. Publicly. No? Okay, well, I saw BP Earthwatch had a video from them, and I saw that the Hawaiian News had that, but apparently the USGS doesn't have it on their page. I mean, I'm on their page. Let's click on videos. Live stream is available. That's it. Drone flyover done, not released on their website. Okay, fine. You know, I can't go over to BP Earthwatch's site and play it for you. And I can't go over to HVO's or to the Hawaii News site and play it to you because they'll claim copyright. They'll claim they own the video. Even though we know it's a USGS video, correct? Man, okay. Well, all right. If we want to see the collapsed trees, you're going to have to go dig up that video yourself. And again, right here on the edge of the caldera, which means the caldera is growing and nobody can dispute that anymore. Oh man, now let's look at what hit since last night on the West Coast. Look at the stretch of twos. We have a 2.1, 2.9, 2.4, 2.1, 2.7, spread out almost equally across all of California. Well, there's something going on while California is moving. Let me turn on our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed, and we'll look at all our smaller quakes. What we're going to see here are a few stacks, a few swarms of events that should stand out to you. Take a look at the screen. So this is the last 12 hours worth of events since my update last night. It's pretty obvious. We still have an ongoing line of earthquakes going down the creeping section of the San Andreas, but our most recent event, a 2.2, Huron, California, next to Coalinga. And for people in California who know, you already know what's there, you guys need to pay attention to the screen. Look at what I'm getting ready to show you. Our 2.2 earthquake is coming in where? It's coming directly in next to an oil patch, an oil pumping operation. And our pipelines and our storage tanks, we also have gas being done here, gas extraction, fracking, some people call it, wastewater injection. This is one of the largest pumping operations in California. Not an exaggeration. They start to look like ants on the ground. That's how many different pumps and jacks we have here, the well heads, where we're seeing that just get extracted over and over again for years, and that creates a weak point in the crust. So the largest event striking there. Then, within the, that was last night going into this morning. Last night's location was upgraded to a 2.9 to 3.0. It was at the mid-range 2 last night. Now it's at 2.9. Now, that may even be listed as a new quake today, but it's within the last 24 hours, 2.9. Well, I'm not shocked at that, a 2.9, because we go back a day and a half, and there was the 2.8 that struck up here near San Francisco. So same size movement going across the entire area. As we go over to the east portion of California along the Nevada border, our swarms at Mammoth Mountain, Aurora Bodie Crater, and even going down to the nuke test sites are all cut in half or disappeared entirely. And same time that those are cut in half and disappeared entirely, Southern California has lit back up with new swarms going from east of LA past Big Bear down to Salton Sea. Right in the middle, ANZA Gap, the slow slip location in Southern California, moving still with the most number of earthquakes. But the biggest movement happening directly on the flanks of Salton Sea Volcano. And Salton Sea Volcano was elevated to active in 2012. They said they based that on new dating of rocks. Well, we know that's not really why they elevated it to active, guys. In 2011 and 2012, all this sulfur smell started to come from down here at Salton Sea, and they tried to blame it on seaweed. And then it came out later, it was hydrogen sulfide, which is not from seaweed, it's from volcanism. And we have geothermal pumping operations, which are right on the flanks of the volcano. Not just there, but going all the way down to the border. I showed you El Centro last night. We showed you El Centro was hit last night. And this is the pumping operation, the geothermal pumping operation that I showed you last night. Well, we've moved north right next to the volcano itself. Salton Butte's Smithsonian place mark is right there. You can pause it and read it if you need to. So I mentioned a word, slow slip, or the words slow slip. That's a term that's used by professionals to describe when one or more plates goes in motion side by side of one another. Now, Laurentia, North America, is in motion side by side with the Pacific plate. It's my contention Pacific plate's more in motion than the United States or Laurentia is, and the Pacific plate is pushing or nudging or applying force and pressure on the western portion of the North American plate, Laurentia. When that pressure is applied, the plate absorbs the force and tries to transfer it across the plate and equalize the pressure, evenly distribute it out across the plate. And as that happens, earthquakes strike equally across the plate, almost all the same size over the course of days. And it happens this way regularly. So on the West Coast now, in the last 12 hours, you're going to see our clusters. And I can name several of the other locations out for you if you need me to. But, I mean, really, starting up here in the north, Black Butte Volcano, going to the east, Sugarloaf Volcanic Butte, going over to the east further, we're at Black Hills. So Black Hills, Black Butte. We'll go down to the south, we're at Mammoth Mountain and Aurora Bodie Crater. Go further to the south, we're down at the Volcano Peak with the geothermal pumping operation there at Devil's Kitchen. And then our creeping section of the San Andreas. So obvious that we have a big cluster of earthquakes there. So obvious that it's in motion, and our pumping operations at the oil pumps are just to the east. Now we have one lone earthquake, 2.2, striking northwest of LA at this point. Now we showed that to you last night. We are due west of the pumping operations in LA. And that is all tied together. There's only one other thing I do need to talk about. Another earthquake has struck up here at the pumping operations just south of Yellowstone next to Jackson. And I'll show this one again, Hoback, Wyoming. But it's another earthquake on top of what hit last night. Yeah, they're pumping. They're doing fracking, wastewater disposal, and injection. So injection breaks the shale apart, and then it releases the gas and oil, and they collect it. And here is Yellowstone Park, just as a point of reference. If you ever drive up here, you'll drive right up here. You go through the Tetons up into Jackson. Well, it looks like these look like sand dunes right here at this point. Now, you might not even see them at first, but it takes a trained eye to really be able to spot all the little pads that are cut out in here. And all the pads are different oil and gas pumps. So we're talking wastewater, and you see how big this is, right? You see all the little square pads. Well, that's not the only spot. That's just one example. We go all the way up this whole thing here, and you can just zoom in and you'll find they look like sand dunes. They really do, till you zoom in and then you start to see it. So wastewater disposal, fracking, oil production going on right south of Yellowstone. Yeah, you know, I don't know about all that, guys. I'm just a YouTube video maker. What do I know? What do I know? I don't know anything. I need to relearn geology according to all the professionals. Well, hey, look up here at the border. Look at the border of Washington and Oregon. Two 1.2s at this point, right at the border. Last night, I was just complaining about one. Now I'm complaining about two. Do you think Mother Nature can sort out where the border of Oregon is? Do you think Mother Nature is going to stop at the border of Oregon? Or do you think humans aren't reporting earthquakes out of Oregon and they're stopping right at the border because their little computer program is too freaking efficient? How about that one for the most likely Occam's razor answer? Or you believe that Mother Nature is just finding the border and stopping the earthquakes at the border? Now that I've called this out, we're going to get an earthquake thrown on the feed too, because we know that they're listening. Who's listening? The people who run the network up there. You know how I know they're listening? They've issued press releases about me, totally ripping me apart years ago before I ever even noticed that the earthquakes were stopping at the border of Oregon. So, most seismically prone state in the country doesn't get any earthquakes, ever. And when they are, they're listed as explosions at people's houses. It's a joke. It's a joke. And I'm putting this in the book. I'm putting all this in my book, and future generations are going to know about it. And do you think they're going to believe? Who do you think they're going to believe? Me or the lying ass agency that I'm discrediting? When I put the proof out there, and I'm asking everybody, scientifically speaking, how do you explain earthquakes stopping at the border of Oregon? Scientific explanation, guys, need an explanation scientifically. How does Mother Nature know where the border of Oregon is to stop the earthquakes there? Is it Harry Potter? Is it Voldemort? Is it... what is it? Whatever it is, you'd have to believe in magic. And I don't. Sorry. Well, not that kind anyways. So there we go. There's our update for the United States and for the planet right now. I'm going to save this as a video over on YouTube for people to watch. Oh, hold on. New 4.0 earthquake has just struck right on the letter X in Iceland, fully fulfilling our forecast for Iceland. Wow, guys. All right. Iceland was just hit. There it is. Now, why did a 4.0 earthquake hit in Iceland? Well, I told you, we get the same sized activity that strikes down in Greece, travels out across Europe, and hits in Iceland. Well, what happened this week? Don't you guys remember? A 4.0 earthquake hit right here off the coast of the UK. And we told you force was going to be traveling out to the letter X's. And to the north has already been hit by a 4.4 from the 4.4 down to the south. So we get a 4.4 down here. We get a 4.4 up here. We get a 4.0 right here. We get a 4.0 right here. Force travels across the plate. And there it is, right before your eyes. So you don't even have to take my word for it. And if you're a professional, You should. Your mind should be blown right now. There's a 4.0 earthquake striking right on our letter X. X marks the spot. Proof you can put an X on a map and have it get hit on a regular basis. Proof you can forecast. But the relation between the two, that both 4.0s are caused by the same force that's traveling across the region. It goes from one point to the other. And this 4.0 that hit in the UK, it came from previous activity. It came from previous fours that hit down here in the south Aegean Sea. So there it is, right before your eyes. It still blows my mind when it happens real time before your eyes, because they all said it was impossible. All the professionals, all the people, all the talking heads, everybody. They even said I was a hacker. They said I was hacking the USGS feeds to add in earthquakes, add in small earthquakes, to make it look like I'm right. And I said, wait, what? Like the lengths that people will go to try and justify their disbelief. You know, it's like they don't want to believe it, so they come up with creative stories as to how it is that it can't be believed. It's like, surely I must be right. He must be a hacker or something, because I couldn't be wrong. No, he's got to be an expert hacker. I can't be wrong. Yeah, guys, thanks for giving me credit for everything. I'll go put that on my job resume when I apply to the NSA. All right. You guys, have a good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night. Truman Show style. Drink your Makoko. I'm drinking my coffee. 8:32 a.m. Central Time. Probably a good time to save this as a video. Get it out over on the tubes and let you guys do your magic to get it out to the world. Tell everybody, earthquakes are not random. If you ever hear anybody say, oh, I'm worried about an earthquake, you say, don't be scared. Be prepared for it. You can see when it's coming, like the storm. And they'll be like, what do you mean, see it coming? It's an invisible force. You can't see earthquakes. And you say, yes, you can. You can see the earthquakes which have already struck. And they're striking in a progression that heads your way. If you live in an earthquake-prone area, you can watch these earthquakes come your way. And you can be ready for it. It's like watching for a storm. And just like when storms form off in the distance, you see the dark clouds on the horizon, you know it's probably going to rain, you start hearing rumbles of thunder as it gets closer, you know it's probably going to hit you. Well, in this case, same thing for seismic activity. We can see it off in the distance, it's gathering in dark clouds in certain areas that are clustering together, and then we see the storm spread out and come our way, and it spreads and follows a certain track. And the track that the storm, the seismic storm, follows are the plate boundaries. So the plate boundaries are the spots we watch, and then that's where the pressure comes from. And then that's where when we get a 5.0 earthquake striking on one spot of the plate boundary, we need to watch what I call downstream. Downstream implies something, doesn't it? It implies a flow, does it not? It means there's no randomness to it. So we look downstream from spots that are currently moving, and the force flows downstream. Now, downstream is a relative term. It can be up a hill or down a hill or up an area or down an area. It's a flow in the plate, but it flows in a direction. Away. Now, which way? Away? It flows away from the deep earthquakes. Out and away from the deep earthquakes. Once you get that your head around that, you can start to forecast earthquakes. It's that simple. And then you can apply the rules that we've developed, the principles that we've developed over the past several years, which is fulcrum points and how to calculate earthquakes, and, you know, how the relation between areas, volcanoes, and what they can cause. There's several different rules and principles that have to be applied, but they're all very basic. You know, I found that middle schoolers and high schoolers can even get their heads around doing earthquake forecasting. It's not a complex mathematical procedure of equations and numbers. It is a basic addition of magnitudes on all sides of a silent zone. It's kind of the basic low and high pressures of meteorology, and this is translated down below the plates. So you can then share this with the world. You can say, hey, earthquakes can be forecast, and we can know when they're coming, and you don't need to be scared anymore. You need to be prepared, and man, that will relieve the fear of a lot of people who right now have been deceived by the professionals into believing. It's a belief. This is like a religion. It's a belief that earthquakes are random events, natural God events, where you can never know and you always have to be on guard. It's like always being on guard for a burglar. Eventually, you're going to get worn down, right? So you got to be prepared.
Don't be scared.
And you need to watch. Peace out.